I was sent a sort of almost a literal translation from the Danish of the film that was made and indeed was shown here at TIFF.
Called Silent Heart.
Silent Heart, Still Heart. And I saw within it a kind of germ of an idea of something that I thought could be very powerful and strong. It's a film about a death. It is a film about euthanasia, but it's not a film which is an issue film. It doesn't really debate the issues around euthanasia. The event has been preordained. It's been discussed by this family. The family are all meeting for a final weekend at this very isolated country house by the sea. So in an odd way, it's like an Agatha Christie movie. You know, we know there's going to be a death. It's what surrounds the death which is so fascinating. And it's brilliantly using the event of this woman's death to anatomize or explode, if you like, this very complicated family. And I suppose that's what I found interesting about it. A lot of the film is people sitting around talking, and I think that's probably what interests me most about making films or making plays, is people sitting around talking. Mm-hmm. And this film is the absolute apotheosis of that. And I think it's come out well.
The great Canadian filmmaker David Cronenberg says that the best part of cinema is just that, you know, interesting people saying interesting things.
Yeah, you can sit in a room with people you don't know, and mm-hmm. you can sit next to them around a table, and you can eavesdrop on their reality. And this wonderful cast absolutely persuades you of the truth of really every moment of their performances. And I think that's a testament to them, but it gives the film its life and its humanity and its vitality and its fun. You know, it's quite a funny film. It's not a dreary, miserable film entirely. It gets pretty sad at the end, but it's got wonderful life and truth in it. I think with this sort of subject matter, you have to guard against, as you say, too cheesy, too much fromage in the mixture, because it'll just be repulsive. By that I mean it'll repel people from what you're trying to do. I mean, they're very practical in the film. They made a series of practical decisions which they've thought through very carefully. Susan's character is quite a control freak, which is very characteristic of people who euthanize. They're quite often not depressive. They're actually extremely coherent and logical and controlling about exactly how they want to die. As Mark Twain once famously said, never put off till tomorrow what you can put off to the day after. And I think that if I was approaching the weekend when I was going to top myself, I would find an excuse. You know, there'd always be one more day. You know, why don't I wait till Monday? Then at least I can see this thing on TV that's on Sunday night. So that's what's so telling and wonderful about this story, is that Susan's character, even when offered the choice of postponement, is absolutely savagely decisive about what she's going to do. And I think that helps to leaven the sentimental kind of ingredient, if you like. Suicide is perfectly legal, isn't it? You can commit suicide without breaking any law. It's this very complicated area, which will be very complicated, I think, to legislate around, of helping someone else commit suicide. So I became aware of those issues. But I suppose I became, having read a lot about people who'd gone down this road, deeply compassionate about those who had really struggled to be permitted to kill themselves, those who were incapacitated to an extent where they could only do so with someone else's help. And of course, in England, many people go to Switzerland, to Dignitas, an organization which carries out these procedures legally. But if you are the spouse of such a person in England, and you, for example, drive them to Heathrow Airport, you can be arrested for aiding them in a criminal act. So it's quite complicated. I intentionally didn't watch the original movie. I'll probably watch it after this is opened, and I'm looking forward to seeing it. But I didn't want to be constrained or to be in some way influenced by what I hear is a lovely film. But of course, I worked very extensively with the writer, the same writer, Christian Torp, on this script. So through that genealogy, I suppose I had a connection with the original film. Decided to shoot, as you said, to shoot in this house, which is virtually entirely made out of glass. So that conditioned and absolutely controlled our schedule, so that we were shooting in the autumn, weren't we? This time of year, in fact. So we had increasingly less daylight. We have lots of night stuff, which is good. So we were able to start shooting our night scenes at a reasonable hour, 5 or 6 o'clock in the evening. But it wasn't like a conventional movie set. We didn't have tons and tons of lights, and I don't like spending time on set watching people lighting. I like spending time watching people acting. So we managed to achieve that. Although the film isn't an issue film or a campaigning film, I think it's unavoidable that the film doesn't condone, but it almost celebrates, certainly normalizes or makes acceptable what this woman and her family end up deciding to do. So in that sense, I suppose it is advocating a change in the law.